We're in it to win it. When we break from this circle, you are your characters until that curtain call. Get it?
Got it.
Places, everyone.
What I believe in, yes, sir, what I can see. And what I see, that old Gene Talmadge is a friend of the farmer.
Herman Eugene Talmadge and all of his constituents are charlatans and demagogues. He's not a poor dirt farmer. He's an educated man with a Phi Beta Kappa key. He doesn't care about you. Yes, he's for the county unit system, but that's only for the votes. He goes around to these farming counties and uses you to get ahead.
Seems I'm having too much fun tonight. Y'all go on ahead. I'll catch up with you.
One of the most picturesque figures in the political history of Georgia died just like that.
Wow, it's terrible.
I wonder who becomes governor now.
One of his physicians said death came as a result of acute hepatitis, which caused the failure of his liver cells and continuing hemorrhages of the stomach and intestinal tract. The body will lie in state from 1 until 5 p.m. today at the state capitol, and funeral services will be held at McRae at 2 p.m. tomorrow. Barry will be there.
No constitution woes. Eugene Talmadge died today.
He's dead!
What else awaits?
That the General Assembly have no choice but to elect me as governor.
All right, let's hear it. Got something prepared?
I do.
Cool.
In the state of Georgia, there has been an attempt to confuse the minds of not only the members of the General Assembly, but the people of the state of Georgia as well.
That's a good start. What else do you have?
For 93 years, there was not a popular vote for the office of governor. Governor Troup, who was elected in 1823, was the first governor of Georgia elected by the people. Under the trustees, the governor was appointed
Herman,
by them.
That's just too much. People don't want to hear all that.
He's right, Herman. You'll have lost them.
Should I just cut this part right here?
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. It seems that this year, 1947, we are forced into a situation of confusion. In times like this, we look to our law for answers. Now, I'm not here to make my own case. I'm simply here just to inform you people. This situation would not seem unreal to the General Assembly. What they have to do is necessary, considering our present situation. They have before them experience to make this decision.
Yeah. Keep it short and sweet, just like that.
We don't need to hear an entire essay to be convinced that you're the right choice for the job.
Now, from my understanding, I've been forced to work under a false label created by Mr. Ellis Arnold through the newspapers. He has tried to inform you people that...
Herman, are you really just going to call him out like that?
You heard what he said about me last week. I've got to tell these people this.
I guess. Go on ahead.
The legislature, voted by the people, have elected me governor as Georgia. I believe that I can carry this state, and I believe that I can work with this state for the people. And I believe that I have the ability to make the decisions that the state needs to run as a good state.
I like that, Herbie.
All right. I think you got it.
Thank you.
Still be stalling the legislature.
Right. This is exactly what happened in Germany with Hitler. You know, first they take your freedom. What's next?
Well, let me tell you. What do you call it when Ellis Arnold takes over the governor's office? I call it tyranny.
Right. As if we need this antiquated daddy's boy. We're already the laughingstock in America, and now this?
A decision about the next governor of Georgia.
I told you, the people of Georgia want Herman Talmadge.
We can't do that. Emmy Thompson is the lieutenant governor. He deserves to be in power. You all know that.
What do you think?
I believe that it should go to Herman.
All right, guys. Gentlemen, we need to make this decision. We are already the laughingstock of Georgia. We're already the laughingstock of this country. We have to make a decision today.
The death of the Honorable Eugene Talmadge after his election by the people and before publication of the returns by the General Assembly did not change the duty of the body to declare his election nor authorize the General Assembly to declare by resolution that because of his death, no person had a majority of the vote and to elect a governor. Accordingly, where in such circumstances the General Assembly undertook to elect another person as governor, namely the Honorable Herman Talmadge, such attempted election was a void act, which did not confer upon him any right or title to the office of governor. It follows that upon the resignation of Governor Arnold on January 18, 1947, Emmy Thompson, the duly qualified lieutenant governor, became vested with full executive powers of this state.
So
doing this performance and being in this class, performing the archives, has really opened my eyes to just history and politics in Georgia, just history and politics in general. It's really taught me that nothing has really changed about politics. Just the time for me. You would think with all the technology, if it was having done, it's just the same drama, the same controversy, all this type of stuff, and different views, so.
I have to agree with my friend here. It's surprising to see how much politics haven't changed. I thought that this was a crazy year of elections, but then we learned about this. It's something you haven't learned about in your history classes. It's a crucial part of Georgia history, and I think that it kind of paves the way that we need to have plans for our future instead of being a mess and confused of what's going on.
For me, the most important part about taking this course and being able to study through the archives was that you really look at our state and its politics over an extended period of time, and you realize that we've been through ups and we've been through downs, and every time we went through the downs, we rise back up. And I think that can be said not only for the state of Georgia, but our country as well.
Before I took this class, all my endeavors in theater had kind of been like independent, like I relied a lot on myself. But this was so different for me because we all worked so well together as an ensemble. Like, I leaned on them for, you know, when I needed help for my script, when they needed, you know, thickening of their, you know, storylines. We were all there for each other, and that was just a really refreshing take on theater.
Every part of history is important, and in order to learn from history, you have to first learn it. And so that's what we did here today, and I think that theater is important because for a lot of us, we either don't have the time or don't have the discipline to sit down and read a book, and so that's why we put it in a visual form. And in terms of learning through the archives, it put us all in different positions that we weren't comfortable with first, and we came to learn different things about ourselves and different things about Georgia. And so that's what I really enjoyed about this.
I'm quitting the archives, biz. I'm going to Hollywood.
From you, your take as to your experience of walking through this journey into archival fragments and embodiments. So we open it up to you all of what strikes you, where
is it sitting in your bodies? That's the way we talk in theater.
But open it up.
And questions too for the ensemble.
So I'll ask a question. How does it generally make you feel about democracy?
I mean, I think not only in this class, but just like this election period, like it's really opened your eyes to like
your vote matters, like what you believe matters. But this class specifically, just like during this time period, there weren't any rules for what happens when like our governor dies. And it's just crazy to think that it was just like open-ended. We didn't like think about anything that like that would happen before. So like I said, like we need to put in place like order for our future, and not just like our time now, but we need to think about the future.
Anybody else? Well, I will say the way that Herman Talmadge got involved in the mix is that a lot of people knew that Eugene probably wouldn't make it. So they started a whisper campaign and had a ton of people write in his name. And there were actually two people in front of Herman who were just kind of like, I'm not getting my hands dirty. And so they dropped out. So like, technically, did Herman get in legally? Yes. Was it the most like
ethical
way? No.
One question I know the ensemble has, for those of you who walk through all of the scenes, what's the story that you glean from these fragments from the archive? Anybody want to take a gander? Anybody take notes on their nifty little fill in the story card? Yes.
I just have to say, I thought everything was beautifully done, and I really learned a lot. I think it was wonderful. You guys are great.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
I like the way walking through space, you know, because you're filtered into the library, so in a certain way is also walking through time, right? The story unfolds. I'm sure you planned it that way, right? No, the story unfolds. I mean, it unfolds linearly as you are walking, moving straight through linearly the space, and that was. I thought that was a very good way of planning, moving us through the backstory to all of this.
Yes.
Did y'all's heads explode when Hillary contracted pneumonia during the campaign?
I mean, you know what to do, right?
People? I mean, were y'all actually writing y'all's script when that happened?
Ironically,
yeah.
Yes.
We've been working on the script pretty recently. So it's, and I think that's like a great time for this class to happen.
Yeah.
Like the political aspect of this class and then going through an election year. I thought it was really well balanced between now and the past.
Yeah.
Learning about the governor's controversy kind of, not desensitized, but just open my eyes to how crazy politics actually can be. Because you watch the TV shows, like you watch things like Scandal, you're like, oh my gosh, shit doesn't happen in real life. Then you read about the three governors controversy and you're like, wait, how?
How did this happen?
Literally, how did this happen? So yeah, just kind of made me more open to the possibilities of politics.
I think that the first day that we really talked about three governors controversy, we were all just like, what? Yeah, like how, like we were so surprised because I mean, you've taken Georgia history, you've taken history throughout your entire schooling and this just never gets touched on. So it was super interesting to see how our government, our Georgia government was set up before this.
Mm-hmm. And what you might find fascinating is that our approach is what we call devised theater, which means that we begin the semester with no script, with no sense of who's taking the class, but we build a performance based on who we are, the gifts and talents that we have, and what happens when we interact with archival material. So this class really asks a question, what happens when you let artists loose in the archive? And originally we teamed up with Jill Severn and Jan Hebbard. to work off of their Dynamite on the Stump exhibit. What does it take to get elected in Georgia? And so we originally started by going systematically playing with the archival material and themes of each part of that exhibit. And the last theme we landed on was the Three Governors controversy. So literally 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, after 9 weeks of experimenting and generating this material for other themes, the ensemble shifted once we landed on this story. There was a question, I saw a wonderful hand back there, yes.
Yes, I was gonna ask if you purposely did this to coincide with
the presidential election that we were going through for the last 18 years.
Jan and Jill, you want to speak on that, especially with the exhibit tying in?
Sure. Yeah, we had no idea that things were going to be as crazy as they were, but yeah, I think we thought it would be a great idea during a presidential election to do something related to that, which is why we have an exhibit about the really about politics and running for office and how that's changed. But I think we didn't know how it was going to change, you know, how it was going to sort of unfold. And I have to say that this morning, that one of the things that I said to Jan was, gee, I hope people feel are will come. You know, because some people are rejoicing at this election and some people are not rejoicing. And so it makes a difference, you know. History happening now is influencing what our performance.
That's yeah. Right. A hand right here.
Well, I'll have to say that for me, I feel like I'm living history right now. Mm-hmm. To come Absolutely. To this performance, you have solidified that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it just blows my mind to think of what we're in right now today. And to see you performing what was, I just think it's phenomenal the way the two have meshed. Congratulate you.
I like to, I'm sorry.
We have a co-op. Okay. You want to follow up on that same point or? Okay.
Well, go ahead.
Teamwork.
I just have a quick question. As somebody who didn't grow up in Georgia, I wonder if anybody in here who did grow up in Georgia, did you learn about this in school?
Absolutely not.
How many of you are from Georgia who grew up in Georgia?
Okay. Wow, that's wonderful.
And I'm pretty sure it's in the, like you said in middle school it's a Georgia studies class
it's a specific Georgia history class, not touched on.
How many of you have actually got this taught in your classrooms? So out of those hands, we just had one.
That's interesting.
So you just recently or just in the past few years?
2 years
ago.
You know, I followed the lady over at Bernie Harris Middle School 20 years ago, who I heard her mention this. So I know she was a Georgia born and raised, and so I know she taught it.
Uh-huh.
But I just wondered, apparently nobody else did. Very few did.
I can give a little on the ground sort of information in that we have every eighth grader in the Clark County Schools comes for a tour in this building at some point during the year. And there's a big mural, if you haven't seen it yet, in the Russell Library. And these folks, Melvin and Ellis and Herman are represented. And they all know who he is. So in the Clark County schools right now, they're talking about. They know about the three governors. So maybe it's come back in fashion.
We brought it up.
Look, can we turn back to your hand, sir? And
we're together. Well, we were blessed with having time in our hands, and we came to all Jill's presentations for the last month and a half that they've had leading up to the elections.
Yeah.
And really, they've done an excellent job, and this is it really has helped us come each week and learn the different steps that we've talked about. Mm-hmm. And it's so ironic where you said, what did you think when did their heads explode when Hillary came out? Because she had a couple of hot shots here from D.C. that were writing a book proving on statistical analysis over the last elections they could guarantee who was going to win presidential elections. And their last words when they left here is, Hillary's up 6 points, and unless she has a heart attack during one of the debates, she's gonna win.
Wow.
And bada boom, look what happened.
Wow.
You know, you just never know.
You just never know. We're actually living history. A couple more hands? Yes.
I want to ask the students, is this your first opportunity to work with historical records? And
yes.
What did you think of the experience?
I thought it was actually pretty cool. I had heard of device theater only because I've heard it before. But it was interesting. I was like, when I first got into class, I was like, how is this gonna work? I mean, I get the idea, but how is this really gonna work? So as like I'm going through the weeks and learning about different people in politics and learning how to turn an archival material into a script, was interesting to see. And we kind of used Hamilton, the play Hamilton, as inspiration because that's exactly what he did. So yeah, it was pretty cool. That's
working right. with the archival material was really cool. One of the first couple weeks we were in here, we were just kind of learning how to deal with the archival materials. And we held like UGA's like first yearbook.
Unofficial.
Yeah, we're not.
It was the first time they had put together all of the UGA students' pictures in one book, and they had like written their names and their year under it. And that was the first unofficial yearbook. But like we had it in our hands. Like somebody decided, hey, we should keep this. And we got, and like hundreds of years, 200 years later, we got to see it and be inspired by it.
Last hand.
So you looked at other archival materials before you started looking at this story, right? So how did you come to choose to play out this story, and how did the things that you looked at ahead of time or before this story influence you and influence your choices?
Before we kind of picked this story, it was kind of every week where we were assigned like a different activity. So one week we used archival material to write a song, and then one week we would write stump speeches. So every week we had something new, and it wasn't until we watched a YouTube video on the Three Governors controversy and we were placed in those roles that we kind of, it was our kind of our first time getting together and being like, wow, this could actually be something, like we could actually turn this into a production. And that's how I felt, at least. I think that's kind of how we all felt. It was one of our
spoke to us. Really.
I feel like what we should do right now.
Sing a song.
Yes, this, no.
Ooh,
come on.
Right.
What is it? What is it?
Dun dun dun.
Right here.
There's a great. It has great music. The video.
Very dramatic, music. like in your face music the whole time. It was.
Yeah. And I think leading up to the. To this event. I think for me, and maybe for y'all too, like doing the campaign songs and doing the stump speeches and how to gather support and all that kind of stuff actually kind of put us in the shoes of Herman Talmadge and Ellis Arnold and Henry Thompson to see, kind of feel what it was like to campaign so that when we're able to do this, we could kind of understand the situation a bit more.
And this story is just so broad that, you know, taken, I think we started at 1900, 1910, and moved all the way to like 2012. So imagine this, except we're trying to jam like 100 years of history. And so like with this, it was like one complete story that you could glide through as opposed to us trying to jam. Because it's really something that you savor, and it's really something that you walk through and just immerse yourself in.
As the instructor record for this class, my name is Dr. Amma, by the way. They call me Drama with an extra M. I have to just publicly thank Jill Severin and Jan Hebbard specifically as dynamite collaborators. Without their collaboration. And this is the outcome of this wonderful program that Jill co-developed with Chase Haygood, formerly of the Center for Teaching and Learning, called the Special Collections Libraries Faculty Fellows Program. And this is the first year where part of that cohort of faculty members here figuring out how to bring archival material into our classrooms. And I have some of my fellows right here. Cynthia Camp, who's here, and Kristen,
our star.
Oh, Kristen, yes, and Kristen Smith is here as well.
And go see her posters, which are on display in the journalism.
Yes. There's a poster downstairs this semester. And so you have the so I just wanted to publicly thank UGA libraries and CTL for allowing faculty and students the opportunity to innovate, to give us a safe space to try, experiment, and most of all for your presence. And Cheryl especially, just thank you for your leadership. This is what archival outreach looks like. I just really thank everybody for that. So thank you for coming. Please go and enjoy the other exhibits in this wonderful building, and we hope to see you at the next show. Yeah.